Okay, it is now 6:30 p.m., and I am calling the Newfain Select Board to order. It is Thursday, September 5th, 2013, and before going to the normal order of business, I just want to take one moment to thank Pat Grace, who has been our administrative assistant and has served us very well, and we're very appreciative of what you've done for us. So
thank you.
And we wish you all the most success in your new ventures. I'd also like to inform the public that Shannon Meckel, who we voted unanimously to appoint to the position of the administrative assistant to the select board, has accepted that position and will be beginning, I believe it's Thursday. It is Thursday. I believe that's September 12th. Okay. Now going directly to the first item of business, which is the minutes of the August 15th meeting. Do I have a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Do I have additions or corrections to those minutes? Hearing none. All those in favor of accepting the minutes as written?
Aye.
Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Passes unanimously. Of members present, may it be noted that Todd Lawley will not be present for this meeting. Otherwise, all members are present. The next is the minutes of the August 27th special meeting. Do I have a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved. Seconded.
Moved and seconded. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes of August 27th?
Yeah, under the school proposal near the bottom, I believe that I emphasized the fact that there's a possibility for a school in the articles for the school to be built, but I didn't say that it would definitely be built. It's one of the articles, so somewhere that sounded a little. We would hold an election to build a school, but it's holding an election to approve articles of agreement to form a different educational district.
So you want to amend that rather than to build a school?
Yeah.
To approve articles of amendment, articles
of agreement.
Articles of agreement.
For a regional education district.
For a regional, so I'm just going to read this back so that Pat, you can get it. It's striking build a school for Jamaica and Townsend and replace that with on October, and swiping the word to, I'm sorry, but swiping to build a school for Jamaica and Townsend and replacing it with articles of agreement for a regional, what was the last word?
Educational district.
Educational district.
And truly, when we said that, I didn't have that language.
All right, that's fine. Okay.
Okay. So it was to approve articles of agreement
for a regional.
For a regional.
Educational district.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other additions or corrections to the minutes? Hearing none. All those in favor of the minutes as amended?
Aye.
Okay, that passes unanimously of members present. Next, we have the road, Foreman Road Commissioner's Report, which we do all have written, the board has written copies of, just to probably get hit the high, or I should say low point. We did a lot of work on the and after the flood on Adams Hill, which with our huge rainstorm over the weekend, some of that was really, that work was unfortunately undone by the storm that we just had. So we were, Todd is trying to get some help from the state, talking to John Alexander and Mark Pickering to see what help we can get to stabilize the flood bank. So that's probably was our biggest single hit. There also was some, I know, on the one of the bridges that we're building got some problems, though I think they were not huge, and Todd isn't saying that, so I should probably shut up. Also, the paving has begun. Blaine will begin the work on South Wardsboro on the 13th of September. I think those are probably the most important items to hit. The other is there has been some work in terms of the Kenny Pond grout, or sometimes some people call it grout pond dam, and Todd has been in contact with a gentleman from Root Engineering, and he's going to take a look at it and see whether we can get him to see it and see if we can do a kind of to fix the section under the town road so that there won't be further damage caused. And he's gotten a price on that of about $3,200. So we'll have to see once the engineer sees the piece of the situation to see what the engineer says, if that seems to be a viable solution so that we can get approval from the dam inspectors.
On number six, under paving.
Yes.
Todd is getting prices on paving on Cross Street, Back Street, and paving around Jail Street.
Uh-huh.
And he says, I'm not sure we would have enough money to do all three roads, but we could use the money on some of them.
Right.
I'd like the board to let me know so that I can add it to Lane's work while they are already
okay.
here.
Yeah.
And I think the tone I get is that he would like a discussion and a motion that we're acknowledging that.
Yeah, I again, and certainly there's no reason we wouldn't get the pricing on them. It does have to be bid, so I don't know how that works exactly, but because certainly, yes.
I mean, because he's saying I want to give it to Lane. So that
he can't just give it to a particular contractor. It does if it's
yeah,
a new
we went on
project.
A per ton, to be per ton price.
We did, but so for a specific project, we still have to get. If we're doing something different from what we said,
if you go on by the ton, you got X amount of dollars, and you can get so many tons for that X amount of dollars. What's the difference?
The difference is the law. The difference is you can't. If we have anything over $2,000, right? So we put it out to bid for a certain thing. Each, we just have to follow our own procedures. Otherwise, we're breaking our town procedures. Say, so we said we are bidding on A, B, and C. If we now say you're bidding on D and E, we have to put it for bid. We don't know that somebody might come in and say, I'll do those guys for much less. You can't, it's not just, we can't just be glib about it. We have to follow our own rules.
I almost think, though, I mean, you had X amount of dollars, you might have said A, B, and C, thinking that you're going to eat up that A, B, and the money on A, B, and C, and actually come in cheaper than what we thought. And
no, that'd be fine.
Had another 40, 50, whatever it was, 1,000 left over, so while you're in town, you kind of take advantage of it and
Could
we do that bidding process in a timely enough manner?
He says in here, I'm getting prices on the paving.
That's fine.
On the three. And he's not sure how far that will carry. And I do understand from him the whole idea, you know, even moving the whole project from here over to the South Newfane side, let's say, is extremely costly, you know, in terms of how the logistics go. So his object is to get as much through that paving grant and the town allocations of capital expenditure to whatever he can over on this side.
I'm not opposed at all to our doing it. It's just we put out for bid, here are the things we want you to do. Mm-hmm. We collected the bids, we opened the bids for that specific work. We're bound by that by statute. As chair, this is not a vote. I am ruling that we cannot violate our procedure.
But to go back to my question, can we, in a timely enough manner, put it out to bid so that if Lane is here, it could be added to
I would have absolutely no problem with putting it out to bid immediately.
Yeah. But
we just can't play fast and loose with bidding processes, and we're talking here about things that are in the hundreds of that, you know, over $100,000. We can't just say, oh, you guys, we're going to do this, now do this. I will not do that as chair. I'll accept that.
Well, a little bit strikes me as odd, too, that we had originally put out to bid to do the paving for the park and ride, and then that got dropped totally. And now we're saying we're not going to put any of the paving money into the park and ride one, but we'll go ahead and see if we can do other areas?
Specifically, I think what we did with the park and ride is we asked in the solicitation of the bids, and hey, by the way, include as a separate line item an idea of the cost to do this specific project, because that isn't under the VTRANS or our capital expenditures for paving. It's under a separate grant.
Yeah, we have not
completely separate.
We have not voted as a board that we will expend money for the park and ride. If we get the grant and get the money back, we could do it. But this is totally separate. He's talking about the grant, the funds that we allocated for road paving, which is not the same as park and ride paving.
I think that would have been nice if it had been clearer to me as a member of the select board, because suddenly that went out, and then it went out for a bid without my knowing it was just going out for the two roads.
No, I didn't. I thought it was open. But anyway. Bottom line, do we have a motion then to put out for bid, because I do think we should do it as soon as possible and see if we can hook it on to what Lane is doing, a motion to put out for bid the paving of Cross Street, Back Street, and Jail Street?
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on that? Hearing none. All those in favor of putting it out to bid?
Aye.
Was that everyone? Is there any negative or abstentions?
No, I agree with it. Okay. I just think that it might be cutting our own throats. Might get a higher price next time on the rest of it.
You might get a lower. Look, Mike, I'm sorry, but as chair, I've made a ruling.
No, I know. That's what
and,
it's a little
and little. We have a very clear procedure on procurement. This is a large procurement. We have to be very explicit. And imagine if you were the contractor and you lost a bid, and then the guy said, then we, the board, said, well, we're going to, you, since you gave us the lowest bid on that job, we're giving you this other job.
Well, you know, I think as the contractor, I'm not going to go and get into that part of it. I think they all knew there was 260 some thousand to spend for paving, whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's down to like 200,000, right?
Well, 68, I don't know the number.
Well, I mean, roughly 60,000 left over to do this other paving. When they bid it, they were putting the bids, I think, estimated on $260,000 or whatever, you know.
Well, no, but they bid on specific places.
Per ton price.
But those change depending, if you recall, the prices we got when we included, when we first did it, we did it a set of things, and we got some tremendous range in prices, in part because the parking lot was included there and was a very different price per ton. So price per ton can vary on location. Mm-hmm. So we can't...
Yeah, parking lot's a lot different than doing...
I understand. I'm just saying it can differ, right. And we're bound by statute that if we say we're going to spend this money to do this thing and right. put it out to bid, you can't say, oh, I'm going to spend that same money to do that thing and give it to the same contractor without a fair bidding, an open bidding process.
Here's my question. When that bid was sent out to the contractors, paving contractors, mm-hmm. did they know a dollar figure that the town of Newfane had to work with?
Well, they might. It's published. It's
but,
not.
But it wasn't part of, oh, we've got $260,000.
No.
They had, you've got this
well, this,
mileage,
this has to be, exactly.
Whatever.
That's the way the bid
so
process works.
I'm not sure, Mike, if they really did know that they had this pot of money and we're going to get
but it. But it sort of doesn't matter. They,
well, yeah,
I understand your logic that it's simply a per mile thing, but you can't, we're bound by, we said this is what you're bidding on, and we can't, suppose you said we're not bidding on Lynchbridge, you're bidding on, you'd add a glow bid on Lynchbridge, we'll give you the next bridge. Well, we can't do that.
No, I know that, but I guess...
Same from the legal perspective, the fact
I mean,
that...
I mean, I know some of the bids, when they come in, they had them set for the whole amount, which is a lot of money. I mean, I know you don't want to talk about it.
It's not much more we can do. I mean, you know?
Yeah.
I mean,
well, it's the same, like,
the board wants to overrule that. I don't care. I mean,
that's what it is. See what comes in there.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, all you can do if you don't want to do it, you save it for next year when you get more money to throw it all together.
Pat, did we have a time frame on getting that bid out? Was part of this motion?
We did not say. We want to do it immediately. If you could do it, put it the start the bid process, do the... We could get three bids on the phone, honestly, if we want to. We don't have to... If we do it by phone, this is not something that's going to be federally reimbursed. We should make sure that it's okay with V-Trans, which I think Todd could ensure. Now, maybe that's a compromise we could do.
Well, if they're going to start on the 13th, that's before our next meeting anyway, so I think you kind of have to. If you want to try to get it...
Well, we could have a special meeting to open the bids. But if we do the bids, Bob, I'm willing to accept the notion if your concern is timing and not wanting to lose these things, or Todd's, is timing and they're here. My concern is that the appearance of preference. You don't want to give appearance that because some or one group commonly does your paving that they have preference over other bidders. It was, as I recall, actually fairly close between the bidders in terms of this.
Could we get the names? I mean, go back in the minutes and get the names of those who submitted bids and make sure they all get called.
Yeah, I would be fine with Pat making. You were here tomorrow, yes? You're not here tomorrow. Well, we don't have an administrative assistant until the 12th.
Is there any reason that Todd could not obtain all three
okay.
bids?
I would accept that. I would accept if Todd would seek bids from the other people who submitted bids.
Okay.
And by telephone, then we would at least be. I just don't want us to be creating policies and then ignoring them.
Are you going to contact Todd?
I will do that.
Because again, the...
Okay.
Don't we have to have the specifics of mileage and blah, blah, blah?
Yeah, but the most critical, as Mike points out, is price per ton. That's what we decide upon. So if Todd would lay it out to each of the people who send in bids and assure that the... And honestly, we are not even required to accept the lowest bidder. If we are convinced this is the best solution, that would be fine. But we do have to request the bids.
So when would we want to have the bids?
Well, immediate, if they could give it us, that's a good, fair point. What would people say?
By the 13th.
Or even earlier if you want. I mean, yeah. You're right. So if we could say a week.
Yeah,
it's not a complicated bid process. So if Todd would seek them, so the notion that we're talking about here is that Todd will contact the others who bid on the paving.
Yeah.
He would solicit bids and by telling them all, giving them all the same information. And then I would accept the notion that the motion is for Todd can select the bidder that he has the most confidence in that's a reasonable rate, you know, that's within range.
But we have to meet as a select board.
We don't actually. We could authorize it and say we're giving authority to Todd to do that. And I'm willing to do that. I just don't want us to be not to pay fast and loose with our own policies.
Try to get it back by September 12th.
Okay. At the latest. If he gets all three within a day, he can act immediately. Okay? Okay. So how about that?
Sounds good.
All right.
Where do we stand with motions?
We need a motion to reform. We have a motion on the table, which was made. If you could withdraw it and rephrase, we'll start over.
I will withdraw the prior motion.
I was going to say, yeah. Hadn't that been?
We didn't. We just discussed it. We hadn't voted.
And I withdraw my second.
Okay. So now you want to try to formulate it, Chris? Maybe that.
I'll make a motion that the board request that Todd obtain three estimates from the bidders that had already bid on the paving and to get those at least by the 12th of September, and that Todd also choose
We're designating Todd.
Yes.
We're delegating the authority to Todd to select the best, to what he considers
the
best overall. Okay, that's been moved. Is there a second?
I second.
It's been moved and seconded. Okay, is there any further discussion?
I will call him and also tag an email. In that email, I'll let him know that I will direct the three calls that he makes in writing in an email back to Shannon, so it'll be available to her on record.
Good. Great. Perfect.
But do we need to qualify and say, and no later than September?
I think it would be no later. No later. The motion should be no later. You said by the phone. Okay. So it's been moved. Is there a second?
I second.
We did. Okay. We were actually in discussion. Okay.
Yep.
So is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes unanimously of members present. Okay. Excellent. There are no scheduled members of the public. Are there any unscheduled members of the public who wish to speak?
Yes.
I think we were scheduled, weren't we?
Well, we didn't schedule you, but you can come in as an unscheduled. So
it doesn't matter. You were up to unscheduled. So you're
like
welcome
schedule.
To speak. But if you want to wait till you're scheduled, you're going to have to wait till next meeting.
Okay. Right, well, I'm Johanna Gardner, and I'm the. I don't know if I need to stand in this. And I'm the representative of the town of Newfane to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District. And Bob Spencer, the director, is here, director of Wyndham Solid Waste. And Skip Bonnet, who's a driver, and I don't know if you have
I'm the assistant operations manager and a driver.
Okay.
What's your name, sir? I just didn't hear your name when you
My real name is John, but everybody calls me Skip.
And your last name, Skip?
Bonnett.
Thank you.
And he's the assistant operations manager.
Yes.
And
how do you keep your
and so he comes up to Newfane to take the containers away once a week. But although I guess you.
The last couple of weeks we've done it twice a week, but normally it's once a week on Wednesdays.
So there's been an ongoing issue with the containers being too full, with garbage being next to the containers. They've put a camera out there now as of a couple weeks ago, which I hadn't noticed, but this evening. And I've been trying to look at the boxes as I'm going by. And I, one time I caught them very full, but generally it seems like they've been pretty good.
It's been great. So, it's been much better now, and we've even had another town ask if we would take over their town, and we said no. We said, why not? Because I'm following our people in that's using your containers now anyway. So
We catch people from out of here putting trash in our containers. There's going to be trouble.
Well, so Bob has a lot of figures to share with you. He's gone back and checked the history of how much tonnage there's been. There's also a huge new law, which you've heard about already, relative to, what was it, Act 148?
Yeah.
That he'll tell you more about.
Okay.
I want to thank Johanna for first of all being our representative. She participates in our board, and we have a very active board, 19 member towns, and we often have 15 towns present at our monthly meeting. And each town, most have two delegates. We have to acknowledge Doris as our chairperson for a number of years, and great asset also. So. Anyone has questions, just interrupt me. I just wanted to, for some of you who may not be familiar with the district, because we're just kind of folks who haul your boxes, but you do contribute on an annual basis through an assessment. Last year was about $20,700. It changes each year. We try to finance as much of our operations like a business out of the marketing of the recyclables that we collect and process and bale and sell. 2 years ago, we had $800,000 of revenue. This year, we're barely going to hit $500,000. Mm-hmm. It's because of the world economy. The markets are down. Tonnages are down. People aren't buying as many things. The recession and all that. So our assessments are going to have to increase. We're a chartered municipal government, and we have the authority to raise funds that way.
You explain that? That's interesting. You're a municipal government?
Yes, Wyndham Solid Waste Management District.
Huh.
We have a charter. It was recently updated to conform with state statute through the legislature, of course.
Okay.
And anyone's welcome to our meetings. We handle a lot of issues besides just the recycling. But I'm here to talk about your containers, and Pat has been in communication with us because, and you're not different than any other town. My town of Vernon, we have the same three boxes, about 2,000 people. We're on the border of Massachusetts and New Hampshire. We have people coming through using them. Ongoing issues of trash and people throwing trash in them, leaving trash.
Right.
Sometimes we get hit hard because of, you know, I know after a holiday weekend, people are coming down Route 30 and they're stopping off. Plus, you're talking about a park and ride lot. You know, what does that mean? And I guess gather that's not imminent, but.
Right.
So, Skip, what we decided to do is evaluate. We didn't want to really do it because we didn't think it was worth it, but collect twice a week for a period of a couple weeks. So, we did that. And I have the numbers here, and it's basically just what we thought, because we've been doing this a long time, that it isn't worth it to come up here for boxes that are a quarter or a half full.
Right.
And literally, it's, you know, it probably costs us $300 to come up and service those boxes. In a 1 week to have that, again, is a lot for our budget. But we wanted to try it as a good faith effort to see, you know, can we manage it and make it better. We would prefer not to do that, and so I'd like to talk about one of the things that we could do. We've mounted a security camera that is reading into our office. It's recording continuously, so whoever oversees this out here, you are not going to be doing it, obviously, but looking out your window.
But Shannon will.
You know, if there's an incident of illegal dumping or something, if they call us, we can then look at our camera footage and say, well, here's a car with a New York license plate, Connecticut probably. And
let's not asperge our neighbors, you know.
It wouldn't be a Vermont. So
it could.
Anyways, we have some chance of maybe identifying someone who's done something.
Okay.
Not that it's a criminal act.
Presumably the sheriff could, if there were something serious enough. We
work with the sheriff's departments.
Okay.
And Brownsville, we work with the town.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about wanting it twice a week, there were a couple weeks where they got over full. And, you know, however that happens, then it's a complete chaos.
Well, this is what we wanted to tell you. Well, go ahead, explain how you can call in.
Well, what we can do for that is if the box is full before we pick it up on Wednesday, all you have to do is give us a call to our office.
Okay.
We have an extension. You push number 6. That goes right to the driver's phone. And you just tell us what box needs to be picked up, and then it's full, and we'll come and get it.
Oh, okay.
Some towns are on an on-call basis, but you guys are pretty regular.
We don't normally, I have seen a couple times.
But, you know, after Memorial Day weekend, I think that was when we had a big hit, you know. Mm-hmm. And we don't have a problem coming up for special things like that.
Okay, great.
You know, the other thing is, now, it's my understanding from Skip and Johanna, there is someone who does pick up litter around the box. Is that an employee?
Mm-hmm. Yes. We hire someone.
Okay. Well, we'd like to suggest one more activity for that person. And that would be to use a hoe or a lawn rake and push, when the materials are being filled, to push it back into the box, because people lay it right by the openings. It doesn't work so much with the cardboard because that's a narrow opening and it's designed that you can't move.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But the commingled bottles and cans, they tend to accumulate at the closest to the parking area, and then on one side in particular. And it would just literally take a few minutes just to push. And the stuff is lightweight, and the paper slides if you push it.
I'm not sure what I'm not totally understanding.
Pushing it away from the from the door, pushing it back in.
I see.
Center. Yeah.
And Skip is willing, if that person is here on the Wednesday when he comes back, just show him how we do it at other sites.
Yes.
The thing with this person is we really ask him to come after the bins have been picked up so that he gets all that debris and it doesn't stay there. You know, I think that's something. I'm the town clerk here. I mean, you could show me that. That would take...
It really doesn't take much time.
There's no time at all.
And it's only when you see that it happened and pick up maybe the next day and...
Exactly.
And what happens, people drive all the way here, and they get there, and it's there, so they just leave it on the ground, and then good old Skip will get it.
I mean, I'd be willing to just do that kind of on a daily basis.
I think it's manageable. Right. Looking at your tonnage, just so you know.
That has to go to an open bid.
you rarely get the optimal weights in your boxes.
Mm.
By managing the materials, you can get greater tonnage in that.
I see.
And really, it's all about hauling costs. And, you know, the more tons we haul, the more economical this is.
Yeah. Well, actually, I was just thinking about that whole thing. Like, you know, you might have a week where you might have come twice that one week. But you, like, say, the on-call thing. Would it almost pay to go on to an on-call instead of every week? So maybe 10 days once in a while?
I don't think so. Not in this situation. We have a certain schedule for certain places that we pick up on Wednesdays. Like, actually, every day we have a schedule of certain places, and the other truck goes and does other things. I think that would throw it out of balance too much.
Okay. But it is possible if we wanted to.
All right.
Well, but like you're saying, you're going to start poking it in so you get the whole thing full, and it is full.
It usually is full on Wednesdays.
Yeah, by Wednesday. And honestly, and somebody is a user of it, as they get to their full mark, it does get more difficult to get your stuff in, and then you're going to get more...
Well, it's still
badly, you know, like emptying your bottles rather than just shoving the bag in there with it.
Another issue with the commingle box, the glass in the bottle room, people think when it gets to the level of the bottom of the door that it's full. That's not really true. We fill those all the way to the roof.
Right. It just gets hard to come in sometimes. The one thing I would ask, when can you, if the assessment is going to increase... We are going to go into budget. Is there a point in time when you will tell us what the
assessment... It'll be December.
Not till December?
That's our normal budgeting process, right, Dara?
That's correct.
It's been that way. I've been with the district as the director.
Well, if you could give us can you give us an estimate? In other words, when we do our budgeting primarily in November, so we hope we're done by December, so we'd like to know... What the cost
we formally vote on the budget at our December meeting.
But if you have an estimate I would,
yes,
we would appreciate an estimate. If you, you know, we're not going to hold you to it, but it just helps us to know where we're going to stand.
We're already doing it.
That's what I'm asking for.
And we don't blame you because everyone's budgets are.
Sure.
Yes.
So is it generally in the 20,000 range?
Yeah. But it, we don't know. This year it could increase significantly. Right.
That's all we need.
We haven't done that.
But don't do it!
Yeah.
But I understand. You'll have to tell us what it is.
He was telling me outside about the tonnage. You didn't tell him.
Yeah, well, I did the numbers for one full 12-month period, ending just like August. And Newfane had a grand total of 203 tons of recyclables. Mm. We break that out by each of those materials, cardboard, paper, and containers. And I have all, anytime you want that, we have very detailed record, everything scaled in, scaled out, reported to the state. But just to give you an idea of what that's worth, the district pays for trash disposal at $100 per ton. So does Jamaica. You know, it's kind of the prevailing rate around here. So that avoided disposal cost for your residents who use is on the order of $20,000 a year.
Which is about what we're paying.
Which is about the same. And then, not that's just coincidence. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. So, in addition to the recycling services, the district does other things for the our members. We run the twice a year household hazardous waste collection events.
Yeah.
And we do have them here in town. We have them and we move them around. Next one will be the first Saturday in November. And I actually don't have the schedule of which towns, but And we also take care of all this, the state mandated solid waste planning. That's called the solid waste implementation plans. And we are also now gearing up with this new Act 148, which I brought some information to leave with you.
Okay.
Great. So there's a bundle of services.
Great.
And then we are also expanding our recycling education programs. We would be glad to provide the town with flyers. I brought some that if you wanted to distribute, if you have a town.
It would be good to have us to distribute to people.
A town newsletter or whatever.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, we drop them off with the schools. Sure. Actually, last year, we our program coordinator, Kristen Benoit, and I spent 3 hours at Newbrook Elementary setting them up with composting bins and worm composting. So we do an outreach and education.
Great.
But these are, if you have a newspaper, I don't know if you do or not.
We can scan that and put it
on the website.
Yeah, that would be nice, just so people can. It's on our website, too, but
great.
We'd like to give everyone. Yeah. You can have these.
Okay.
Great.
Yeah, then we have we drop them off. But we do provide that materials.
Doris?
We send those notices out for the recycling to all of the new owners.
Oh, good.
Oh, that's right. Thanks.
Well, that's terrific.
Yeah, I just want to ask them, would you anticipate with the new law that the need for the recycling bins will increase? And I think you mentioned park and ride. I got the illusion that maybe there's going to be an increased potential for that.
Well, that was what I was just talking to Pat. If you're having people coming down from Jamaica and towns and then ride sharing here, then they might naturally want to bring their recyclables if it's more convenient than going to Jamaica transfer. So there's potential.
Okay.
We're actually dealing with this in Putney and Westminster right now with park and ride lots.
What's happening?
Oh, well, they haven't built them yet. They're all this same funding you're looking at is now coming through. And so we want to integrate our recycling stations with the park and ride. There may have to be additional signage. There may have to be, I mean, the thing is, they're really open to any resident of the county. Okay. The towns don't typically say only Newfane residents.
So at least they ain't throwing it beside the road.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
John, do we need to hear a little bit about this Act
148? Well, I'm prepared to do that. I just wanted to mention the other thing that we're working on, and this is really is we are promoting, and I know you don't want to do this at this site probably, but composting of food waste. Mm-hmm. And we have drop-offs in Dover and Vernon now and in Brattleboro where residents can bring food waste. And I'll leave these brochures with you. This is what we collect. And if you can, you could have a dumpster here that was available for residents to put in food waste.
Okay.
And that's the heaviest recyclable item we collect. It's like ton per ton.
Oh.
Just briefly, does anyone have any questions?
Well, you know, we have a bit of a problem here. We're supposed to have a recess at 7
okay.
for a liquor control meeting. And also, this was unscheduled from yes. my narrow perspective. So I would like a quick summary, and then I'd like to move on.
Okay. Well, then I'll just leave you with this. There's copies for the board. It's Act 148, a summary of the law.
Oh, that's very
good. And the timetable for implementation. And anyone who's interested, there's a whole website.
If you just read that aloud, that you have.
Okay. It's an infrastructure analysis for what's. Basically, this law is mandating recycling. It's never been required in Vermont, including leaves and grass, do not put in landfills. Including the bottles and cans and paper, cardboard, will now be prohibited from disposal. But the big change is that the state is going to require that the haulers who service all of the state offer recycling at the curb whenever they collect trash.
Hmm.
So this comes back to your question.
Oh, really?
If every resident has recycling services, do we need the drop-off boxes?
Yes, we do, because...
It's a question.
It's been brought up all over the state.
We should have a discussion of that.
So anyways, we have subcommittees that are dealing with this.
Okay.
Johanna's very aware of them. She attends some of them. So I would say that I would be glad to come back and have a whole workshop.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, that would be great.
That would be.
You've got until next June or July 1st to... Okay. To basically start with it.
Thank you.
Okay. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. I thank each of you individually, Doris and Johanna, for representing us and taking care of this. And I also very much want to thank Bob and Skip for taking the time and coming here and informing us and letting us know. We really do appreciate the services.
Just in closing, for one quick thing, Pat has my cell phone number. You folks can call me anytime.
Okay.
Any problem at all, just give me a buzz and we'll see what we can do to take care of it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you
for coming. We're now going, we have a brief recess actually planned. I don't know. I think we still should probably have a motion to go into recess.
So moved.
It's been moved to go into recess and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And we're now convening as the Board of Liquor Control. We have two applications before us. I don't really have them quite in front of me. One is for the Williamsville Eatery, and the second is for the Newfane Market. So I don't know if there's anything particular that needs this. This is not a new liquor license, right, for the Williamsville Eatery?
That's a brand new one.
That's a brand new one. Okay. So this, what do they have right now? They have no license. Is the eatery the creamery?
No, the
eatery?
Williamsville.
Oh, the Williamsville.
Richardson's.
Could you speak to this if you're
sure?
The applicant could speak to it. I'd appreciate that.
So the old Williamsville store.
Are you going to open it up again?
We are indeed.
Excellent.
So we're dealing with the state. We're dealing with lots of permitting right now. We would like to serve beer and wine as kind of secondary, not as a main.
To us now, or to
with your approval. Not as a main thing. We don't want to be a bar. We're not a main. That's not
right.
Really the main focus. But we would like to have beer and wine be
sure.
a component. It's going to be a little more of a departure from its general store and deli roots. We're not opposed to bringing.
Are you? Could you, I'm sorry to just to bring me up to date. Are you new owners of the store or old owners?
We're leasing.
You're leasing the building. And were you out there working on the steps today? Is that what I saw you?
You were up here.
Good. Good.
Yeah.
All right. So that's why you're asking. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. And in terms of the store, they have had a liquor license, yeah, so this is a kind of re-getting it, right? No, we're not talking about you guys. We're talking now about your application. Do you want to just speak to it for a minute, what it is you're applying for? Just tell us.
Well, I come back in May.
Right.
And if I knew a good explanation why I'm coming back.
You would tell us, but you don't know.
And the governor's office looked into it too, as you know, what's going on, Department of Liquor. There's been a breakdown of communication there for some time, and hopefully it's at the point now where things are ready to go.
Okay. So. Okay. Okay. So do I have a motion to approve, and I don't see any reason we wouldn't do them together, these two applications for liquor licenses, one for the Williamsville Eatery, and the other, what is your store officially called, Justin?
New Bay Market is the doing business as name.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
So moved.
Okay, it has been
second.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
We will need to sign those.
Okay, so I'll leave them with the signed things to be signed.
Town clerk.
Okay. Okay.
And I have the checks.
Then it has been, we will sign it tonight, and it will come to the town clerk, and she'll have it, well, I guess Monday, presumably.
Will we need to sign anything else?
No.
You've already signed, I believe. Okay. All right.
Thank you very much for coming in.
Do you have an estimated time when you might be opening?
A little hesitant to say at this time, because something out of our control.
Do you have a hope? How about a hope?
This winter is a hope.
Okay. Okay. All right. I think you should become a politician. I think you got all the qualifications right there. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Yes. Did you want to say something? Good. Okay. Do I have a motion to adjourn the Board of Liquor Control?
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The Board of Liquor Control is adjourned, and I will reconvening the Town of Newfane Select Board. The next we have is access and right-of-way permit applications. Pat, what do we have here?
This is Tom Martin. They had applied for this previously. It's 11 Otis Lane in Newfane, Vermont. There is a diagram. Todd has looked at this and approved it. So it's just a matter of the select board voting to approve.
This is an access permit? Is that what this is?
That's correct.
They bought property.
Go ahead. Could you explain, Gloria?
Yeah, they bought property and they didn't like where the driveway was, so they asked to have it moved to a different position.
Location, okay.
Well, actually, I don't know if they're going to move it, but they proposed another driveway.
Right, that's what you,
okay,
that means
maybe,
the same thing.
Maybe, and they have
I see purchase what you're saying.
Property, so.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the application for access right-of-way permit for Tom Martin of 11 Otis Lane.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. The motion passes unanimously. Next, we have errors and omissions. Doris, you want to tell us what this is about?
I think you have the copies.
You have the
original. Somebody has the original.
It's probably in the pile of things to sign.
Oh, that's correct.
Okay. The one for Richard Nado from Cannoli Village. He left Cannoli in September of 2012, and his trailer was confiscated in March or April of 2013. We did have his name on the list from Cannoli. We didn't take it off. So he's on the list for being taxed, and he shouldn't.
I see.
Yeah.
I see.
That's
okay.
It. That's that one. And the other one, Krista and Anthony LaFord. This was one that kind of fell through the cracks for the flood. Irene.
Uh-huh.
And it's on 54 Hunterbrook Road. There was damage to the land. The camp is in very poor condition. It's been vandalized. There's no heat, no bath. Wood stove pool is in poor condition. So we went up and looked at it and determined that the price that it was at, $49,000, should be reduced to $22,300. And most of it is the land.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the two that we're recommending for a change.
Okay.
And on the liqueur, I just want to, she would like, or her and her husband would like, to be able to get some other land that abuts them. It just so happens that the town of Newfane has 1 acre piece next to them. But you don't have to think about it for this here, but.
Well, if they would come to us and approach us, I think we'd probably be more than willing.
Yeah, I just wanted to throw that in.
Great.
It's like, it's a 1 acre piece just above their property.
Okay.
Tom doesn't need it. We could maybe put it on the tax rolls again.
Why not? Why not?
That's
a great way. Okay. We seem to be always going in the other direction. So,
this is to regain.
Yeah, no, I know. So I'm glad. All right. So do I have a motion? Do I have a motion? Excuse me. And we have decorum.
Where's that? You never get to use this.
Do I have a motion to approve the correction, these two corrections that have been presented to us, to the grand list that have been presented to us by Doris Nechtel, our lister?
So, second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes unanimously.
Thank
you very much.
And again, that has to be approved and comes to
you. And we'll have to sign and comes to you when we've done. Okay. Thank you. Next is the asbestos bid opening. Do we have bids?
No, none came in. None came in. We advertised it. This is for the hazardous mitigation.
That's fine.
Oh,
that's
tell,
okay.
Tell us
okay.
What's...
The reason that it's fine is because it's pretty much par for the course. What we'll do is, as we go into demolition on these, we can make a choice on that bid to either go to the state and get a referral and make 3 phone calls at that point per individual property, or put it in within the demolition bidding itself and have the contractors go ahead and do it.
So you can handle it.
Absolutely.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then the bids are opened and closed. paving, well, we've already talked about the paving.
Mm-hmm.
The school board proposal, I think the board was aware of it and received documentation on what is that there is a proposal, and this is about the uniting of the boards into the single large board. Is that what this is about? Could someone who has, does anyone have more knowledge than I do, which doesn't have to be a great deal, to talk about? Gloria, you want to tell
us
about
this? I've been in touch with Stephen Johns, and what the vote is on October 8th is to actually adopt all of the articles. So there's the articles of agreement that on our copy starts on page 2.
Now this is open to all citizens, is that correct?
It is. I would hope it's sort of, it's an Australian ballot.
So
we're going to vote yes or no on shall the voters of the town of Newfane adopt these articles.
I see.
And then at the same time, we have 4 positions for Newfane that need to have, if it passes, we have to have a board of directors. So they're going to put those in, so Newfane's ballot will have those 4 positions open. And essentially, I think it's really crucial for every single voter, legal voter of the town of Newfane to read this,
because mm-hmm. it's to basically make a K through 12 school board that will oversee all of the education for all of the five towns that go to Leland and Gray.
Does this dissolve the existing boards? Does
yes.
it replace the existing boards?
Yeah. If mm-hmm. this passes, it replaces all.
So it's just one board.
One board for all. But you've got to read through here to say that, you know, if this happens, this is going to be done. Mm-hmm. Wynn Hall never came into this, and so if the four towns of Newfane, Brookline, Townsend, and Jamaica pass it, Wynn Hall will become...
Wyndham or a Wyndham?
Wynn Hall. Wynn Hall.
Okay, I just see Wyndham Board of Directors.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it's Wyndham.
Yeah, I see Wyndham. Dumb.
Oh, it is Wyndham.
I see Wyndham.
That's right. Wyndham, not Wyndham. Okay. Wyndham's near Fallonville.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Bus driver that he is. Yes.
Yep.
So anyway, it's, as I say, crucial. I'm going to scan these. No, I've got them electronically and have Bauman put them on the website.
That's a good idea. Yeah, I would just urge anyone who sees the tape to really read this over really carefully and really think it through. And now, is this a meet? Who moderates this meeting? It must be a meeting, or not?
They will have informational meetings, but this will just come in as an auspicious.
Just as a ballot. That's
absolutely.
It.
You're gonna.
There will not be a discussion meeting or anything.
Not at the vote.
I see.
Do we have an idea, because this is an October 8th mm-hmm. vote, do we have an idea of what the schedule of informational meetings will be? Do we know that yet?
I believe that they are establishing that tonight at their at Newfane School Board.
When we post this on the website, so it's available for people to view, mm-hmm. do you think we could hold off long enough to get that schedule of various meetings so that
Absolutely.
That helps to also, right. and maybe even post those out here for people?
And what I mm-hmm. will also do is get them on sandwich boards.
That's great.
We should be able to
have time to get it into the common for the new thing.
For new thing news, that'd be a good story.
Isn't this where the whole... merger of the two schools come into play.
We've got to be very careful.
If they do this, then they're going to interlock in two schools. Yeah, and isn't that what they said they need the new school for? Them?
But that's just one part of this.
There are multiple articles,
and that's one of them for them to look at that. And it doesn't mean that it's going to happen, but it seems to be. As you read this, it's fairly significant. Mm-hmm. There was also something that, when I read this, I didn't realize it, but in 2012, every student in the state of Vermont can apparently choose their high school that they want to go to. Mm-hmm. So those are questions that I have, like, how does that work? Is it going to take, are we going to get people just now staying in Newfane but sending their kids to Brattleboro, or are they going to...
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Is that, though, as long as it doesn't exceed the tuition that they're paying, Leland Grant tuition, say if Brattleboro paid more, the parents would have to split the difference or come up with a difference.
But they can still still do that. So it's part of this reading.
Okay,
and
so...
I think we need to have some very specific questions.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Good.
Thank you, Gloria.
Good.
That's been helpful.
That is important, and I definitely think as soon as we do have that additional info, we should definitely have it on the website.
Yeah.
And people should really make use of that website because there's a huge amount of useful information.
And I think another thing to say is that last year when we did just the Leland and Gray budget, out of the town of Newfane, we had only 64 voters out of 1,200 mm-hmm. and some odd.
They're voting on a $5 million budget.
And that was a $6 million budget, which we have 21% or something like that. So almost 80 or more percent of our tax dollars goes to schools.
Hmm. So very important.
Thank you.
Very important. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Next thing is to get them to read it.
Yeah.
Well, and it's not... terribly fun reading.
No, it's not, but I mean, you just said how many people showed up just for that one meeting out of the thing. I mean, same thing right down there in Vernon, it'll stop down there. I mean, people sit back, think it's not going to happen, it does.
Yeah. Okay, the next order of business, I did give the new administrative announcement. It's just an announcement. The next is the Grand Pond Dam. We did talk about that briefly, and there isn't any more to say than that we are pursuing getting the engineering, and we do not have the name of the engineer, and we'll try to figure that out. Next is the town office improvements, and I see a couple members of the town office.
Yeah, well, Dr. Here.
You guys want to tell us what's happening?
As you know, we have two bids that were within $15,000 of each other, and the committee recommends rejecting those bids since they're seeming to us totally unreasonable. In the meantime, we've had an indication of being able to fix the basement for about $13,000, which would leave $30,000 to do the upstairs, which shouldn't cost more than maximum $3,000. And this thing, we're taking that off the table for the time being.
Good idea.
Now, you could take it out of the room.
I know.
But for those watching, if you're watching cable, when the people are referring to is that we have a huge safe that is no longer useful as a safe, that weighs an enormous amount and is larger than the doorway to get it out. Mm-hmm. So it is a major problem and is putting weight on the floor. So somehow or another we have to resolve it, but separating it out does seem desirable. So you want to break up the...
Right. We have two items to bid and then work on this.
Okay.
We have indications that about $4,000 will move the thing.
Mm-hmm.
But the wall has to come down.
Yeah, so it's really the total cost of putting the wall down and back up. But, all right, sounds so. Will you come in? That does have to go out to bid, the $13,000 that you're talking about.
Well, it's,
so,
it's more.
Bears, by the way.
Whatever it is.
I have my line items right here. In which the numbers are really.
John, and what are we?
Sean.
Gunther, please don't answer directly. Let me hear what the gentleman's saying.
I'm Sean Lee, Integral Construction. I was one of the bidders on this project, for this project, and the numbers aren't—you're not out of this world. They're really not to what your engineers spec and wanted done. I have it broken down by line items. I have ways that would actually save you money on this whole project if you would, because what he's doing down here, what your engineer's doing, you have a cistern down in your basement, which is emitting water up through your whole
building. Right.
Now what he's doing, he's not really, he's just putting gravel over the cistern that doesn't cure the water problem. You're still going to have water, a vapor migrating throughout this whole building. And he's trying to cure it by putting venting in around this whole building and putting more powered gable vents in instead of the ones that you have in now. What you want to do is put a vapor barrier down, fill in the cistern, level everything out, put a vapor barrier down, then you don't have to spend $800 on a window that's outside here that he wants vented, louvered, totally insulated.
I don't want to. There are two things. One is I really want the town office committee to be what's the word? Empowered to review this. Yeah, Dennis, you want to speak?
Well, let me just add. I disagree with this gentleman's assessment. We have a high water table here, and that's the issue here. Whether you fill that with concrete, whether you put a vapor barrier down, you're always going to have a high water table. It fluctuates up and down. You can look at the calcium deposits on the cistern and see where that water table settles during the high water. We had our engineer look at it. We were down there in some of the wettest seasons, and other than the cistern being wet, the rest of the basement remains dry. Although the water is down there somewhere, 2, 3, 4 feet, it's down there, but the basement is relatively dry. We don't see a moisture problem in the basement, nor did our engineer. The beams are dry.
The rotted beams have nothing to do with moisture. They're due to powder beetles that got into the They're powder beetles, and they got the supporting beams and have rotted the beams. They need to be replaced along with the other items that the engineer specced out for us. The issue that we had was we had a lot of interest in these jobs, and then the bid went out, and I think there were about a dozen inquiries that you had, Pat?
I think we only, well, we did have a lot of calls.
Inquiries.
That's what he means, inquiries.
And only three people came in and looked at it, and only two bids came in.
So we followed up on that to find out what happened, and the issue was that the way the bid went out, it indicated that you had to take all three jobs. And there were certain people that were like a basement person.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't want to do the same for the attic. And same thing with the attic. So we determined that from just prices that, and brief estimates that we got from these guys, that we could do a much better job, save the money a lot of, or save the town a lot of money by bidding these items separately. And over and above that, these bids were both well over budget. So we wouldn't have been able to go with either.
We have a problem. We have just budget right off the bat. But I think we had talked about this previously, the last meeting, and thought that it'd be fine to go to splitting the bids, and you could obviously bid on the new as it's laid out, and perhaps be the winning bid. So I don't know. I guess I don't even know if we need a motion. We've already asked you officially to seek bids. The first set of bids, it didn't work out. The bottom line is reformulate the bid into separate pieces and go through, probably be Shannon, and get the bids out again. You know, just reformulate the RFP.
One of the reasons, Mr. Chairman, that we left the safe out was safety purposes. We kind of felt that if this whole thing goes out at one time, that perhaps that would get ahead of the game. The floor should be fixed first, basically.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
I would almost disagree. I think that would have to go first. That's why a lot of it was done, because you'd have to, your costs were high. Because you have to spend time and labor to crib all of this to get it outside. To secure this, because you can't level a floor with a 5,000 ton, I mean with a 5,000 pound a piece of equipment on there.
5,000 tons.
5,000 pounds.
100, man. It's a black hole, maybe. Anyway, I really want. Yes, Gloria?
Could I suggest that, could there be a time when the committee and some of these contractors could just sit down and say, because what Sean is just saying makes sense to me, that you're going to spend all of this to level floors, and then you're going to take that off, and it's. But, I live and work over this water table, and I'd really like to see something done. And add to that, I also sent Paul Markowitz of the Efficiency Vermont, who all of the Windham Regional Commission's grant documentation that we had for insulating. And he's looking at it through his office, and he kind of disagrees with having to do all that fan stuff upstairs, because he was very surprised.
Well, I think anything, the thing I would really ask you to do is, if you talk to these guys, have them talk to the people on the town office committee. I mean, you guys have been handling this, and I think you've been handling it well, and I think you're at this point more knowledgeable about it than the select board, and we are kind of looking for your hearing it all and taking it in and come and reach in. We're happy, I believe, to sit there and say, yeah, if that's what you think of, obviously think it through. But I really, and certain, the one thing I would say is, it does, if there is leveling involved, from maybe the safe, it's something to think about there, about in terms of the order of things being done. But so I don't see why you wouldn't even say put three bids out and get the safe as a bid, and then we could look at it, and then you could figure out what the best sequence is.
Could I make a suggestion also?
Sure.
Is possibly have a pre-bid meeting to have the contractors come here to meet with you folks, because they're asking me questions that I can't answer.
That's a good idea.
But I thought, Pat, you were directing those to the engineer.
I did.
You should be answering those questions.
Oh.
Did you have any luck, Sean, when you did you try to reach
the engineer? I didn't try to reach him. The only thing I talked to you about was pretty much just administrative. I mean, we came here, me and my partner, my associate came here. We looked at the project as a whole, because if you look at his plans, it's hard to bid that job unless you're actually physically here on site. And once you see it, you can understand it.
Yeah.
But his plans were a little. It's hard to bid that way.
But I think Pat's suggestion is a good one, to have a pre-bid meeting with your engineer present, and you guys, you know, at least a representative of the committee present, maybe a representative of the board as well, to kind of just get the questions, that everybody's getting the questions answered simultaneously. It certainly has worked well, and when we've been doing these yet larger projects, the bridges, it's a necessity to do it. But it's a suggestion. But I really defer to, at least I do, I don't necessarily speak for the whole board in this, but I defer to you and your committee. Who is the current chair? Do you have a chair of the committee?
No, we're a committee. No chair.
We're okay. Without a chair. Chairless. No chairs. You stand?
Do you stand?
Oh, you sit on the floor. That's a relief. I thought you were all standing up. So I've heard that's the way to have a meeting. Be quick.
We do.
No chairs.
We do have record.
Okay. Thank you. Let's go ahead with your splitting it up, but do think of check out what's the best sequence, because that could be, it could be relevant to get the
individual that did do the cribbing, the temporary work under here, did not feel it was going to be an issue leveling the floor within an inch.
Believe me, I'm not an expert on this, so I really not, but I'm happy to listen to what you guys come up with.
All new EEC codes 2012 require a vapor barrier. It's just how energy efficiency is going nowadays. I mean, it's just something to think about.
Okay, Sean? Sean,
yes.
Thank you for your input. And I'm sure that the committee is interested in hearing what you said, so they may want to, you know, invite you, but I think a pre-bid meeting would be very valuable.
Was it you two, the ones that I emailed?
I received an email from you. Yeah. Did you get an email? I think I got an email. I think it might have been an email on my brain.
All right. Okay, I don't want to, you know.
No, that's fine.
But just please do work through the committee.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. The next is how we're doing on some of these FEMA and HMGP projects. Chris, you want to take over a little bit here and let us know where we stand?
Hunter Brook Bridge. The second abutment was poured. We had a little bit of excess rain this weekend.
A little excess water, yeah, just to test the process.
And on Monday, when I went up taking pictures of this, I was actually pleased. It was working, even though you couldn't find the pump. But it was working. I think it just ended up being a couple of days where Cold River Bridges needed to do a little cleanup, kind of shore things up a little bit and get back to business. I talked to SVE, and they didn't have any concern that it was other than a little stumble, which was nice to hear. So Hunter Brook Bridge is progressing very well, and it appears to be on schedule, even with that little incident. Moving on to Lynch Bridge, I have good news on that. I am now reporting to the board that all the little technical details and issues have been worked out to where I would ask the board tonight to sign the contract for Renaud Brothers so that we can move forward on that one.
I move to do that. Sign the contract.
Yeah. Okay, it's been moved and seconded. All those in favor? No. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. Any discussion?
There you go. Well, I think when Christine says, let's sign it. Let's do it.
Well, we've been struggling with this for a long, long time.
Thank you, Chris.
Chris has been shepherding it through this rather complex process, and it looks like we're ready to sign. So,
And does that mean they'll be able to start and go forward?
What we will do is we'll sign this contract. Renaud Brothers did get the contract as the lowest bidder, and I will not speak for Renaud Brothers. They would then take that. If there are any issues where the timing,
there's still permits,
any of these permits and so on. The bottom line is we do have it into motion, and I think that's where we need to be.
Okay.
And they will come to us and then advise what their staging is on.
Okay. Now, they have to get the permit, so there's not a timing consideration that we're under. Okay.
And just so you know, those have been being worked
in the background,
so they're sitting right there anyway.
Great.
Yeah.
So it has been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on the matter? All right. Hearing none, all those in favor of signing the contract with Renaud?
Aye.
Aye. It passes unanimously of members present. The next item is HMGP.
Okay. We have 5 Hickey Road, 28 Stratton Hill Road. Those have been approved. We got a little corrections to these are documents that are for property closing, so the attorney needs to revamp those with the current dates and so on, and we'll shoot them. I think that email just came in today. 246 Dover Road, which is the little trailer there, that has been pushed through to FEMA in a bundle, and that got done last week. 236 Dover Road, that one should be in preparation for closing, so I'm trying to get that one together. That'll probably end up maybe going first on the list.
Mm-hmm.
279 Dover Road, I haven't heard anything on that, but I didn't expect to, and I might not until October, November. And that one, again, is not an HMGP. That's gone strictly through the CDBG grant. Yeah. So those are all just...
So we're making progress. We're slugging through the muck. Okay, great.
Thank you.
The next is the policies and procedures, and I see a note. I'm not sure why I'm seeing it now as opposed to prior to the meeting.
What those were, you wanted to see the... comments that were made by those signs.
Right. I'm just, I do see this by, and we all now have them, that Deidre is saying she's still covered by the, it's a problem that what she's done. She signed it, but she says she's read it, but she's claiming she's not, that the policies are not applicable to her because she's appointed by the town clerk, and that does not, she is still working for the town of Newton. So she's, the personnel policies apply. There may be things that don't because she's part-time, but she does still work for the town. So that's just is essentially not an acknowledgement because it's got too much of a proviso in it.
Can I speak to my letter to that?
The only problem I have with this, Gloria, is I don't understand why I'm seeing it now, not in time to read it before the meeting, since it's a page-long letter.
Need to have that because this came in.
But you could have emailed it to me at the same time as sending it to Pat, isn't it?
I handed it to Pat with my signature.
I understand. Okay, so, Pat, I would have liked to have got it, but that's a little late. But I can't absorb this much. All right, can we just move it to next meeting? Because then we'd have time to...
And with that, I'd like to, if you don't mind, I'd like to just make a comment since we're talking personnel policy. I would like this board to revisit the entire personnel policy. It does need to be looked at.
All right.
In light of all these type issues, and most especially because of all the new rulings for this health care.
Okay.
So it'd be very, very critical that we go through this whole
fair
thing.
Enough. Okay, that makes sense. So let us put on the agenda for the next meeting a review of the personnel policy. And I guess this the end of this meeting is kind of the end of your tenure. How exactly are you going to do it?
I'm making the notes, and hopefully, well, it will come through with be from the TV to Shannon for any precise. If I've missed things, she will pick it up with BCTV.
Okay. Who will be doing the minutes? Will she do the minutes based on
I hate to
have somebody have to come in and immediately watch the BCTV, but I don't see any way around it.
They come to us.
What?
They come to us usually by Monday or Tuesday.
Oh, no, that's fine. That's fine.
Okay.
So let us in this, we can include what Gloria you've written here, and now we do have it. I would like if the. Personally, at least, I would like an electronic copy, but could you send me an electronic copy? I deal with things a lot better when I have, because I get so much paper. This thing is keeping track of this piece of paper could easily be a problem. So if we could do that, and let's have a full discussion on the personnel policy and the conflict of interest policy to make sure we're all copacetic with it. It does get revoted, the conflict of interest policy, each year. The personnel policy, though, does not. It is just extends from one year to the other. So I think a good close look at it is well advised. So that would be great.
I thought the reason we did that acknowledgement was that every year everybody would have to sign off.
We do have to sign off, but we also actually do have to revote. I don't know if we do the conflict of interest policy. We do have to revote the procedures. Select board procedures are revoted at each new select board. They're not, one select board doesn't bind the procedures of the next select board. Okay. Excellent. So that clears that. The River Rack Shack. Let's all go to the River Rack Shack and have some, what is the beer? Rolling Rock. Let's go to the Rolling Rock. Okay. Gloria, do you have an update for us on the chat?
Yes. This is printed on reused paper, but this is a response from Jim Barlow. So I wrote to Jim on what's the procedures you should take in terms of the Rock River shed, which we call the shack. And I said to him it was deteriorating, and it had deteriorated significantly since Dennis brought this up after Irene. And so Jim said if the shed is a public health hazard, which we seem to have agreed that it was, it could be handled through the health order process. There's a description of the enforcement process in Vermont Town Health. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that we as a board need to ask Tim Schaefer, our health officer, to go and then consult. Once he's got a judgment, then we need to consult him.
Okay, that seems reasonable to me. To have Tim look at it and see if it is, I mean, because we can't at this distance, so to speak, say that it's a health hazard. In fact, we can't say it, period. It's Tim to make the call there. But it's enough of a potential hazard that it certainly seems worth having him.
You still agree with that, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
John and I spent
That was a lovely day. Lovely day.
John,
we won't go into the details.
A nice tour of the Rock River.
Doris?
Who else is?
I've forgotten. Do you know?
Dielt.
They're not local, right?
No. And he came in, I'm going to say, a year or more ago. He had been sick, came up, and he said, essentially, not only is the shed deteriorating, but his whole property has been trashed in its location.
Mm. As a listener, I'm just curious.
Yeah. I think Doris ought to go look at it.
No, but seriously, they should. I mean, so
right.
he I
right.
believe he said he was going to do something about it, but then his health might have been a problem.
Okay, so the recommendation is, and I don't think we need a motion. Well, why not? A motion to ask our health officer to take a look at it. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
Who's going to be?
Well, they will. I'm gonna. Pat will make a note of it. But if you would like to,
I think Shannon should. But
it should be Shannon. It is our.
I think the most streamlined way to do this is if you wouldn't mind, composite this as a notice to Shannon, and at the earliest available opportunity, once she gets settled in, to have her take hold of that.
Yeah, sounds good.
Just add something to this.
Yes.
Back, I think it was probably, I don't know if you were on the board or not, John, but we had a collapsed trailer up on the Woodsboro Road.
No, it's before my time.
And we had to go through the proceedings. And the owner would not cooperate with us. We eventually removed it, attached a lien to the property. Mm. And at a later date, I believe he did sell the property, and I think the lien was satisfied, which might be something that would have to be done in this situation.
Okay.
I think Shannon would
have. But that's a court has to.
Yeah, that was through the court because of similar circumstances.
All right.
It had become.
But we have to take our first step, which is getting our health officer to look at it and write a health order. Okay. And file an intent to pursue a health order. Okay, so if you would note it, and Gloria, if you would pursue it once Shannon is here, that would be terrific. Okay, can we have an update on health insurance? I know I see Chris's name. I probably put it there myself. But there also was a meeting that was here, unfortunately, due to this one case where the open meeting law kind of bit us in that I did wish to be attending, but we have two people who are actually either employees or who are covered by our health insurance, that is the employees and officers. And so we couldn't have either Chris or I could not be there without violating the open meeting law, since Todd and Gloria did need to be there. So, I would like to hear kind of summary, if we could, of what we know about the beyond what we've been told so far.
I did tape that for you, and that's on this machine.
Oh, do you?
It is taped, and Todd sent me an email today saying that he would like the board to vote on this tonight, and the crew does like the Blue Cross Blue Shield Platinum plan. So that's
that's, I'm totally incognito, you know, that's fine, but this is a budget thing. Yes.
Why don't I just summarize?
Go ahead,
go into that, because we really do need to.
Yeah.
We received, and Pat has a copy of, these are the things that the select board has to do. So starting October 1st, let me just give that, would be the great date for us to have all of the town employees, and I think I'm the only other one taking insurance, to start logging on and taking the plan that we want. But prior to that, and December 15th is the absolute last date. So you were talking about the personnel policy. What we have to do tonight is to vote on whether we're going to allow the two carriers. So when the gentleman was here, he said that there are only two carriers, Blue Shield and MVP. Blue Cross and Blue Shield has a national base to it. If you're with MVP, you are only New Hampshire, New York, and Vermont. So Tanya's presentation was very clear that the amount of money that the select board and the town is paying for benefits really gives us the Blue Cross Blue Shield Platinum. So that is most like our policy now. Essentially, we will save a little bit of money as a town, but for this fiscal year, we have to change over to this particular plan of, we have, if we as a select board say they can take either carrier, we don't have to restrict them to one. They get, it'll be a dollar figure in our budgeting that says you, because you're single, will have this amount of money. You, because you're married, you have this amount of money. You with a family, it's this amount of money. And it's that same chart, John, that mm-hmm. they gave us the last time.
Can I just see your copy?
And so essentially, the thing that we have to get in place, and then as soon as Shannon's on board and up and running, is we just have to apply as a town and get our information set there. Then we as a town will not say you have to take the platinum, you have to take this one. We could, as employees and elected officials, choose to go with an extremely high deductible and pay for everything. We don't have to take this one. But this would be the platinum for the Blue Cross Blue Shield will be essentially what we have now at 80% town paying.
I would make a recommendation that we defer the vote on this, okay? And here's part of the reason why. In its essential element, there's two parts. The board must make the decision as to what the town will offer and what that means in money. And on paper, that is absolutely right. The Platinum Blue Cross plan is the equivalent to what we have outstanding there. I don't have any issue with that. What I see in the background here is it will be extremely important to get Shannon on board on this, because there are a lot of other things that the board has to do to get into that plan. We have to write letters to every employee. So there are rulings that the board itself will have to dictate to go out on this side. Then, as you might have heard in your meeting, each one of the employees must do that login and make their choice of what it is they want to have. Mm-hmm. And most of the navigators and the various people that are doing this are saying, you know, if the town can facilitate some help to each one of those employees to make sure that the logins are going through smoothly and that everything is exactly in place, then the third phase of that will kind of loop back around to the town, where the management of every single one of those paychecks and all the details needs to be changed. So that means we've got to get Treasury involved with that. So,
but Maureen was here and she said that's not a problem.
Right. It isn't, but it's you better make sure it's tied together. And since Shannon will not be here until the 12th, okay, If we were to vote anything tonight, Todd isn't here, and it sort of seems like Shannon's.
Well, let me just hold you for a second.
Place.
You started to make a motion. You didn't quite complete the motion.
So I want to defer the meeting.
The decision.
I make a motion to defer the decision to put any plan in place until the next meeting, which I think is the. Is it the 12th?
Today's the.
No, it's not the
12th. No. 5 and 14 is 17.
Yeah, 17.
Okay. September 17th.
Yeah.
No, 19th.
19th. Yeah, okay. 5 and 14.
All right, so there's a motion to defer. Is there a second to that?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. I have to agree with the motion because I don't come close to understanding what's going on here. And what I've heard even in just the last 5 minutes, things that sound to a naive ear contradictory. Yes, we have to choose, but we don't We're not really choosing.
Yeah.
So
the only,
but the real problem is this is a very complex thing. It is a large piece of our budget. It can, what our current costs are, can change as new people come on to, as employees or officers. And I want to just be real clear about everything before we start voting on what we're going to do. I don't even know what it is our choice to make. So I'd like to understand this a heck of a lot better than I do right now before personally saying yes. And that's, I'm just saying my opinion in this case.
And I'm not sure if you understand that the only thing I would like us to pass tonight would be say that they either we're going to restrict them in carriers to Blue Cross Blue Shield, or they would have MVP, or, and we can just say it's your choice as an employee.
Gloria, could I just hold you for a second? Let me just ask you, because I'm really not, literally, not understanding what you're saying. It's just...
Who do we have now for insurance carrier?
MVP is our current carrier. Are you saying that if that we can allow choice or we can... I'm not sure what you're asking
for. Okay, there's overriding Vermont Health Connect.
Right.
And in Vermont Health Connect, they only have two carriers.
Right.
Under each carrier, there are 12 choices.
Right, I understand that.
So all I'm asking us is for us to say is we will allow them to have either carrier. That's their choice. All the select board gets to do is to say we must go with Blue Cross Blue Shield. We must go with MVP, or you can choose.
So, and you're advocating which side of the?
I'm advocating let them choose.
Oh, okay. So that's what you're.
I know what you're advocating, but I'm not. I myself have looked at this, and I'm a little familiar. I'd rather have everybody on board so that I know. Okay, that's an adequate choice for the town side of it. I understand it from an employee's perspective, but I just don't feel like we've got the board together with enough information to say and that's what we should do.
We really run into a problem here with conflict of interest. That is to say that in this case, where, and as is common in a small town, where we have people who are affected by the choice that we make, strictly speaking, they should recuse themselves from the decision making of what choice we make. We don't go crazy with that, but it's just I personally cannot vote for anything until I understand it. I can't, and I don't yet get it. Why I don't, I'd be honest with you, I don't see why we wouldn't let our employees choose if we're setting a cap on the dollars, but if there's something that's written that says you can't cap it, and I don't know that, and I'm voting on it, it just makes me very uncomfortable. And I just, why, there's nothing, there's plenty of time between September 19th and October 15th for people to sign up. We just need to be able to look and feel that each board member understands what they're voting on.
Why are we waiting until October 15th?
I'm not saying.
No.
Who said,
no,
who said that? I'm just saying that
just
that's
said October 15th.
I said the words October. I said we have until you had said, as I recall, there, that earlier in this meeting you said the deadline for actually putting this on record is October 15th. That's the deadline. I'm not saying we should wait till October 15th. That's not what I said.
Employees have to have signed up by December 15th.
Oh, so they got till December 15th. So then,
but there are a lot of things that have to be in place.
I'm sure. There's a lot. We just can't. We can't jump. We just. I'm agreeing with Chris's motion. That's all I'm saying. I've said it, so I don't need to say more.
Okay, John. How?
I think this whole thing is confusing anyway, well, not just from the town's point, but I mean,
no,
all of our points.
It is, and I understand that as a select board.
I mean, that's pretty expensive, some of that stuff, no matter how you look at it.
Well, whatever it is, we already pay
We do pay
budgeted
interest.
For
no, I'm not just saying that. I'm looking like at everybody. I mean, yeah. That's a big nut right there. And I mean, they're telling people you got to have it.
And
I mean,
absolutely. Even if you're
yeah, some people can hardly employed. Feed their family and pay their taxes and whatever else they got to do. You know, it's not going to add another $600 to $1,000, $1,500 a month. I mean,
yeah, I've got a question for the select board. Is when did we know that Tanya was coming? Because I do remember that we wanted to make sure we had somebody come down. Did we know in time for us to warn that?
No.
Okay.
We didn't.
Then that's fine. I suggested to Tanya because she presented it very, very clearly. I don't know if you felt that, Pat.
I think she did, too.
And so I've asked her, would she videotape it?
Well, she did. It was tape recorded.
No, I videotaped. So not, in okay. other words, where, okay. and then she said it would be good to do it with a PowerPoint. So
okay.
while we looked at this, she would actually be able to have a PowerPoint. And it's something that maybe we can get, and she's going to try to fit it in so that we can get these answered. Because absolutely, you know, you needed to hear this, but there are some decisions that if we don't get early enough as a town, as the select board, we may be pushing people out, and this is a mandate.
But why is that? I've not heard.
Because of these deadlines.
Which deadlines?
When you...
I can assure you, Gloria, we're not going to be pushing people out. What we will do is we will make a very informed decision, is really what I'm saying here, and laying it out. And if there's any member of this board or any member in this town that doesn't have full understanding of at least the basics of what is happening, it is a prudent idea to hold this off to make sure that understanding is given. It's just...
I agree.
Yeah, and most of the things that I'm looking at where we sit within this checklist, and that the June and July are clear. The late July through September, which is where we are currently, is to begin to look into these things and what to do. There's if you decide to not, and if you continue, then. So as to answer the question, it's really in October that things really get started, where you establish your account and so on, at least from what you're handing me here. Mm-hmm. So I just don't see why the pressure of this. But in any case, there's a motion on the floor. Is there any further discussion of that motion?
Get a discussion from the floor at all?
Sure.
I just had and this is not a suggestion, it's a question. Is there an option where the town could, as a cost control measure, come up with a dollar amount that they would give each employee for health care?
I believe that's the way it works, actually. We tap the dollar or the percentage, I'm not sure. But I do believe that, but I don't fully understand how it all works.
But they have to shop in this Vermont health care, two carriers. So
no, I understand that part of it.
Yes,
that's what I mean. It's kind of bugging me. Do you have to shop in that thing?
Yes.
Why is that?
Yeah. Well, let's not. Could we not broaden it
right
to the that's a state.
So that's for our next meeting. We'll figure that one out.
Yeah. So John, maybe you know we need to vote on this.
Yes.
But then I'll ask
you
a question.
Oh, okay. All right. So further discussion.
I've got a weird question. All my questions are weird.
Yeah, it's you, Gunther, right?
No, but this is serious.
Okay.
From a tax point, how does it affect the employee, number one, on the amount of money we give them? And since platinum seems to be a very high-grade policy, I understand eventually there's going to be a federal tax on that because it's so fancy.
Mm. Well, I don't know if that's the case, Gunther.
No,
and remember that many of these plans, one of the things to keep in mind with the policies is that while they have names like platinum and gold and so on, one of the most critical factors is what percentage the employee pays versus the the town. So we can control that part of it. Mm-hmm. So we need to explore it. I my knowledge of it, you know, I've just about exhausted in the few things I've said so far tonight. And I would really like to know what the heck's going on with it. It's a complex thing. It's a new change.
And it has a bit more to do with deductibles in terms of the platinum, yeah, gold, and silver.
They each, right. So they aren't necessarily that it costs the town a ton more to do this than that, absolutely, as much as, yeah, some of them have a higher deductible, some of them have this. We need to understand it and then come to a reasoned decision. So anyway, we've discussed it. There's a motion on the floor. Is there further comment on that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor of that motion?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
Aye. One, three. There we go. The motion passes by a vote of 3-1.
Actually, though, can we do it like you said? I mean, you're going to get to the point when it comes to the real vote, and there's three of us that aren't the employees, so don't make a conflict.
Strictly speaking, but recusal is a voluntary thing, strictly speaking, but I would personally believe Todd, and where it's an interesting conflict. On the other side of it, the input of the employees is very important.
Right.
So it does cut both ways. Probably in the final vote.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm gonna recuse myself.
Yeah, and the only problem with, you know, true recusal, and I could be fine with not voting on it, is that we would need to leave.
Yeah, strictly speaking, you could be, but you could be in the room as a member of the town.
Strictly speaking,
yes. Okay, unfinished business.
My question on that what are we going to do so that we make sure we can make decisions by the next meeting?
That's a good point.
Steps.
Well, I would just say, if anyone has any of this information, either online, if we can get it into, if you have any of the information from that meeting in a electronic form, it should certainly.
Did I not email?
You may have. You may have. I'm not saying you didn't. So I think we have the information we need. We just have to do the research and read it. And the other, I will listen to what Tanya said. I would love it if we could get her in again, but that may be asking too much.
I think we also have material from the first presentation.
Right.
Was it Jerry?
Yes, I have that.
We'll resurrect that and pass that back on. I can pull that back up.
Okay. Yeah, so let's.
It was much more than what.
Well, then maybe my research, I might have done a little bit more reading on this.
So anything anyone has, let's just say, please share among all select board people so we really can sit there and not, so I can't sit here and say, I don't know. Because otherwise I'm going to say, I don't understand it.
We'll get Nancy Pelosi and she'll explain it to you.
She's going to explain it to you, Gunther.
I'm on Social Security. I don't have to worry about this.
Until we take that away. Okay. I believe that moves us to unfinished business. There are none, and that moves us to correspondence, which I have carefully hidden in a large pile that Pat had prepared, and I have hidden.
The only thing I wanted to express is that VLCT is putting on another seminar that's on that card. Here it is. Yes.
Here it is. So I'll go through. All right, let me go. This is our correspondence. Mm-hmm.
Did you want me to mention anything about those business things that we have?
No, I think it's really, I mean, you could go ahead while I'm digging through this. Go ahead. Just at least bring people up to date about what's going on. Yes.
There's been a group meeting to try to revitalize not just the economics of Newfane, but also, you know, kind of the spirit of it and try to get a new perspective on. And there were two things that came through to me from the town clerk email, and John suggested I bring these up to the group. And so Anthony Summers, who is from the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, has another Vermont Telecommunications Authority to try to do something with broadband. The committee met for 2.5 hours last night and suggested that we at least attempt to get this application, which is to be done by September 18th. This one has to be through a select board member or an officer who can prepare that. Anthony's willing to go ahead and work with us slash me if people would so desire for me to continue to do that and get this in. It may not be actually any money, but it might be technical for improving available broadband internet services for businesses. So that's one. And then the second one.
So now, let me just ask you something about when I read. Is that the that's the whatever it is, the expansion thing, right? Then the acts, the grant or whatever it is. I'm sorry, I forgot.
No, that's the next one.
Oh, okay. So this is about broadband.
Yeah,
okay.
This one's only about broadband.
Okay. Okay.
Good. We keep working.
Okay. Good.
And then there's a second one from the Vermont Council on Rural Development.
That's what I was thinking.
It's a Vermont Digital Economy Project, and they. Newfane is one of the 17 worst hit towns in the state of Vermont, and we did not apply for this on March 15th.
We didn't know about
15th.
It. I didn't know about it.
Anyway, whatever it was. So the director of this contacted the town to say, you know, we'd really like to see you get involved in this, and there is no specific deadline for an application on this one. But it'll be as there's money available, and there are great areas that the people in the business said, oh, I would like to work with that one, I'd like to do this. So would it be good, like internet interns in public libraries, we thought we'd get the new librarian on board with that. One-to-one assistance for farm and forest business. Just to say, you know, we're interested doesn't mean we have to say we're doing it.
Sounds good. Good.
So on the broadband, though, so the difference between the digital and the broadband is the fact that that is really more of a workshop type of, hey, this, okay, so that's not a problem. When you start saying the town needs to facilitate, then I have to stop because I would want to read that as a select board member. I would want to know what it is the town would get involved with or... You ever move forward with anything?
Mm-hmm. Agreed. Before we move forward, before if something comes to a concrete idea or an idea that even a seriously discussed idea, we need to know about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this one has a deadline for the application of September 18th. Right. So suggestions
for which is this now?
This is the broadband one.
And well, then.
What does it entail, Gloria? I mean, I haven't seen any of these documents. I have any idea. I mean, would the town be acting as a funding source?
No.
Or a. Okay.
But I didn't get the application for this until today from Anthony, and I didn't. But again, I can send out electronically. I think I sent these to you, John.
I don't remember, but you may have. I just don't remember seeing it.
So, there's a whole lot here. We don't have to submit the application. We could always just leave work on it so we can discuss it because we don't meet again, what, until the 19th, which is a day after this.
Could I just see what this is? Does not sound familiar to me.
Yeah,
Well, do we have underserved business districts? Doesn't the business district have broadband?
Williamsville
and South Newfane both have broadband accessible. Does Newfane?
Yeah, we have it here.
We have it here.
So I don't see that we are an underserved business district.
Right.
But it are all businesses. It doesn't mean just Route 30. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not just Route 30. It's Route 30, and we're talking about the three towns. It must include one or more of the following: a downtown village or town center where local commercial activities and public hours are concentrated. That's true, but that's what they're applying to is the downtown. An industrial or office park or district, irrelevant. Okay. An employer of significance to local economy. An area of tourism activity of significance. An area of town containing three or more small home-based businesses with a demonstrated intent to purchase upgraded internet service once available. See, I just see it's very difficult for us to meet the criteria. I did see this, actually, and saw it as, well, I just don't see how it applied directly to us. So
right.
That was my, and I saw that once I got it at some point, it was rather late in the process to do something about it. So I'm a little, anyway, whatever, I won't say anything.
Could you actually scan that and email it, and also to Mike and to Todd, and at least three maybe out of the whole board will be able to look at it
for broadband?
We've got it on Newfane Hill. I know, I'm not sure very many people that don't. Or businesses that are not running efficiently.
I think we would have some trouble.
Well, and that's where there are like nine questions that you can look at it and easily go through it and say, we don't apply.
So what would we be applying for? Is required to determine if completing a response applicant to determine if you have underserved business districts. This application to VTA. I don't know. I honestly don't know. This is one of those where it looks. Well, I'm not going to even say I don't know.
Maybe it looks better than what it.
That's what my feeling is.
And I think the business group, the people meeting last night, were much more enthusiastic about the rural development than they were that one.
All right. Well, if you would, I do have an electronic copy.
Yeah, and I'll just send everybody the electronic copy. So in the future, if I get something like that, will this need to go to the administrative assistant?
It should always go to the administrative assistant, and it should usually go to me as well.
And I didn't send it.
But I think in this case I take some of the whatever blame, if you will, that I should have distributed to the rest of the board, because then you would have it and you could get it. Because I do remember receiving it, and I remember looking at it and saying, I don't think this applies, but I shouldn't have been personally making that decision. So, mea culpa.
But that would be the procedure, to send it both to the AA and
to me, and then we can decide whether it should be, either of us could decide to distribute it to the full board, because I that's some division of labor. Okay. And then do keep us informed whether the rural development thing moves forward. I mean, these things do drive me crazy where they come up with, there's this, it should be great, but you have to tell us within 3 days if you're interested. Okay. The other correspondence, which is along the same lines, which I did distribute to the full board, is this business with Sovereign saying that they could potentially supply solar power to us. This one does not have any deadlines on it. The question here is whether the board is interested enough to have them come and speak to us. And that's what I'm throwing out there. I did distribute it to you guys to take a look at to say whether this was something you thought we wanted to look into or not so much. Anybody have an opinion one way or the other?
Not so much. There is enough literal balls floating in the air right now that are mandatory and critical that I certainly am in no way discounting this, okay? But if it could be deferred to
school board
after budget and
they're the ones looking to see what they can do down there.
Okay.
That's fine.
That's my opinion.
They got a lot of roof.
Well, I'm just reading it. If anyone disagrees, we'll...
It's not that I don't have an interest in it, but Chris is absolutely right.
Okay. All right. It seems to be the sense of the board there. The next is Wyndham Regional would have given us $500,000 if only we'd applied 3 days ago. No, I'm just making it up. There is, I forwarded this to the Conservation Committee, and it just is that there are some funds available for recreational trails. I haven't heard anything back from the Conservation Committee. Did you hear anything from them? They have a series of meetings. Could you put another note that we should really have a follow-up communication to the Conservation Committee to say, please let us know whether anyone from your group will be attending this or whether this appears to be something of value to pursue. Because that's what we rely on them to tell us. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Let's see, this is the solar power. This is village revitalization. There is a meeting on Tuesday, September 10th for the village and downtown revitalization workshop sent out by Colin Meaves. I'll just pass it around if anybody is interested in attending, if they think it might be of value. Please do so. This one is the same thing I already read. We do have a report from Merle. I have one more thing, Pat, and let you finish writing.
No, go ahead.
Which is simply to ask Merle if he would send this to me electronically.
Okay.
It's just the report, and I'll pass it around unless you have it. I don't know, did you put people in people's... You probably didn't make copies.
No, I did not.
So this is just the report of what the zoning permits that have come through Merle in the last... since the last time we met, I suppose. The time. What's the time spent?
Starts the very first in February.
So it's probably a cumulative list is what he has there. And then finally, there is a report from the Williams Hill Hall Committee. The barbecue lunch, the grossed $1,563, the food cost $1,000, et cetera. The hall fund currently has a total of $2,199. And they have a harvest supper coming up on August 18th. They did have it inspected by an architect. We did run into a little problem with the bill, which hopefully will get straightened out because the architect charged for mileage, which was not part of the deal. And the parade, that they're saying the committee decided to participate in the parade. They would like to meet with the Newfane Hall Committee so that they could be more involved in the planning. And they're going forward with other things. The other things are pretty minor. I don't want to take our time, but we do have a report from the committee. And then we do have the report on the Williamsville Hall by the architects, but I will wait for this. I will give this to Shannon so that she can make an electronic copy and distribute it to everyone. So I will do that. I'll put that up on the top.
And finally, there is the town fair coming up for VLCT. That's very soon, October 3rd. I don't think any of us have attended it in recent years, but obviously any member of the board who might wish to attend it, this is a valuable thing to be part of, so I would certainly, it is certainly included in our select board expenses as a possibility, so if one would wish to. Is there anyone who would wish to? Because we do have to delegate, make them a delegate if we wish them to attend. Is there anyone who would wish to attend on the 3rd?
I could wish.
But you could wish.
Yeah.
Where is it?
It's in Killington Grand Hotel.
What's that, for the weekend or something?
No, they're not giving me a weekend at Killington. Sorry, Mike. Good luck. Good luck. It's the business meeting of the town. I am not intending to attend. I don't know if anyone is. Speak now. Okay, I'm moving on. The last item is simply what we received, which is that from New Singular Wireless, otherwise known as AT&T, or doing business as AT&T Mobility, that basically what this is I've read this, and basically they're just informing us that they're, they've filed a request with the Public Service Commission to transfer their certificate of public good to have a different constructor and probably build the tower. So it does look like they're going forward with building the tower, which frankly, I mean, given what everybody said, if we were going to go through all that, that would be, it's like, I was beginning to wonder if they
I figured they'd have it up.
But apparently that's what this is, they're passing over the ownership of the actual building of the tower, and I guess the owning of the tower to another company. They're requesting that of the PSB. I haven't received any notice that there's any, even a public comment requested or listened to, but that's, they're informed, essentially. We did receive a request from Senior Solutions, asking us assistance in the process of looking for nominees for the 16th Annual Successful Aging Award, which is something I was going for until I started service on the select board. And my success at aging seems to have gone straight downhill. But seriously, and you have to be 80, and I haven't quite met that criteria.
Right, shock, so.
But really, nominations are due almost immediately, September 6th. I'm just saying this now. If anyone knows someone who they think really would be a candidate for this, that doesn't require anything fancy from us, but I could personally be glad to send up an application if there is any. So I'd simply say, if you know someone who is over 80 and seems to be doing well and would be a potential successful aging awardee, please get a hold of a member of the select board and let us know.
Be proud.
If you know her?
A lot of us know her.
Yes, but I don't. So I would be happy to sign this, although I don't actually see a place for a signature. Would you feel okay with my handing you the...
It's going to be done by when? Tomorrow?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right.
You coming in tomorrow?
That's right.
No.
But you don't have to come in. It says, and it has an email.
Let's see.
If you wish to mail your application, please send it to...
John was nominated 2 years ago.
Oh, okay.
She might be able to do
what's
that.
What's it do?
Although it says no, all must be received by Senior Solutions.
Right there. There's just a
so it has to get to Senior Solutions in Springfield?
Mm-hmm. Give it to Jenny.
Seems a little late.
So you have not somebody from your town or something like that?
Yeah, and they only award one per year. It's not like a...
Doesn't mean we get...
We don't mean we get the award. They amount one for the whole... Right. Ball of wax.
I was just thinking about that.
Takes no
there's an old guy, we're doing the Senior Citizen House up there in the Townsend. I'm on TV with Warren Patrick. I think he's 102 or something like that.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
He goes wandering all around.
We're going to pass this over to George just for a look. Just a look.
The application is very simple. It's the problem is getting it to spring. If they'll let you fax it in, I bet they would.
Run it up to Ginny, don't worry about it.
Yeah. Where'd she go anyway?
Yeah, I thought it was, maybe that's what, anyway. So, is that okay, Doris, if you kind of, and if you can do it, great. If it doesn't work out, that's okay. Then, this is an energy audit, Newfane audit, WRC grant, etc. I'm going to have to take a look at this to see what it is. I'm not going to take our time now. Probably needed to be acted on yesterday.
Well, I think this is a company that came in to...
Oh, you know something about it, Gloria?
And so he just wrote this letter to actually say that we can't just say, sorry, there's... no asbestos in this building.
No, that's not what this is. That's not what this letter is. It may be. This is about indirect discharges of sewage.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you know that.
I don't know what this is. Draft general permit for indirect discharges of sewage.
I can speak to that. I called that office. It came in, and they were required to send it to all town clerks to post, but there is no indirect disposal of sewage happening in Newfane.
Okay, so it's not relevant to us.
It needed to be posted.
Okay.
All right, so does that go back to your office for posting?
I have already got it posted.
That's just a copy.
Okay, it's our, I guess it's a the additional actual copy. Next is, we have a lot of correspondence tonight. The Local Disaster Shelter Initiative offers communities in Vermont and New Hampshire Upper Valley training and equipment to open and sustain a disaster shelter for up to 72. I thought that's where we are. Oh no, this is a disaster, not a disaster shelter. Because of that, to rethink whether so there's a training in September, but it doesn't have a date. They will reach out to communities, which I will read this and again pass it on. It's basically an initiative to have disaster shelters, and I will take it and report back to the board on this. Okay, that concludes our correspondence, and that concludes. Go ahead.
Just because we have the transition between Pat and Shannon,
yes,
we probably should make some arrangement for those few days for us to come in and clear the messages off the machine, take messages. Part of my worry is there are calls coming in on some of these grants that are in process and what's up.
Now, I don't know what, did I get the, I don't know if I got your, do you have a password you have to enter for the phone?
I do.
I don't know if I got
I
that.
I have left
from you.
A message on the phone saying that I'm out of the office, Shannon will be in this office on the 12th.
That's good.
Could we rewrite the message and just have Pat do the message and say to call me during that time so that if it is a call, I can get to you?
I'll be really honest with you. What I'd like to see happen is I'd like to see that the messages on that machine stay intact and in order. And if I had a preference, like in an office, it's going to be too difficult if I've got thousands of little notes. So if we come in here and pull of those, a log of all those phone calls, and the necessary ones get binged to be called back and so on,
and leave them on the phone.
I think it's cleaner and much neater.
Okay, and leave them on the phone. But so we do need to...
If you're going to do that, Chris, I'll show you what the password is. It is the same as what it was when Shannon was here.
Okay.
That hasn't changed.
Okay.
But I'll tell you what it is.
Okay.
So you
and then maybe we'll, if it's okay with the board, that way we can keep a log of every single thing and we're not missing anything in that interim.
And don't erase them. Just leave them. So then they're all there when Shannon comes on.
Depends on how many come in.
There is a limit.
Okay.
Right.
But maybe Pat message should be changed to reflect please leave a message, we'll get back, instead of, you know, somebody won't be here until it
comes. Okay, right. I can
Let's
handle
do that.
Okay. All right, yeah, because you could point you at the password. You can change it if you,
okay.
the message if you need to. Okay.
Very good.
Great. Let's see. I do think we need a very brief executive session to deal with a health problem. Okay, to do so, could I have a motion to do so?
I'll make a motion to go into executive session for a health issue.
Health concern.
Do you want me to stay?
Yes, and
fight. Including Pat.
Including Pat.
Is that my thing?
No.
Oh.
What, do you have something you want to bring up? Or
I thought we had... What did we
No, you brought something up. That's true. That wasn't that. That could be brought up in an open. You're a member of the public. You could speak on it without.
Oh, okay.
Without our going into executive session. Do you wish to at this point?
You might not want to give names. You might want to just give an address.
Let me withdraw my motion, and we'll continue.
Yes, right. It hasn't been signed.
Newfane Hill Road. I believe it's 164. Has a minimum of 9 cars and or wrecks on the property, a whole minimum bedroom of mattresses, box springs, all sorts of other junk out in the yard. I managed to have 60 reformer boxes removed. It's just a mess. And some of the cars, at least 4 of the cars, I believe, are registered. And some of the others are not. There's a big dumpster full of garbage. What I'm afraid of is that over time, the thing will develop into a rat nest.
Mm-hmm. Well, we do have our junk ordinance, but this is a little... I always think of it as being the zoning administrator, but it's not, right? It's really us who has to. So someone has to go take a look at this is really the first step is for somebody to take a look and see.
What
just
was the number, 64?
164.
164. It's the Tyvek house.
Gotcha.
And you've got pictures on file. Some of the wrecks are still on the property.
Gunther, would you be opposed, since I think this was discussed earlier in time, if we could get together and pull any records we have on that, get some up-to-date information, and then bring that up at the next meeting and have that on the agenda?
Sure.
Okay.
And you've got the last warning from Joe Mandel.
Ah, it's that far back?
That's right. Okay. It goes back to 07.
Okay. I knew I'd seen something on that.
Yeah, I just don't... That sounds great. That sounds terrific.
Very nice people.
Okay.
They came to Vermont. Well, okay.
All right. Okay.
We mustn't...
Now we will... Now, could we have a motion to go into executive
I'll
session?
I'll make a motion to go into executive session for a health issue.
Second. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Gunther.
Night, Paul.
You're going to run for select board?
And if there's anything...
I'm 79 years old. I want to make my 80th birthday.
Okay.
I don't...
Then you could make that aging award. Yes. No. There will be no motion coming out of this. So you can wrap up.
Should we vote on it?
What?
Oh, we
have to vote, you're right.
Second somebody?
He did.
Oh, you second, sorry.
So it's been moved and seconded that we go into executive session to discuss a health matter. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you.